Today's subject is Illumine Your Comprehension. I can say this is the whole subject of Patanjali. This is the subject which Patanjali is expressing through these whole sutras. Illumining your comprehension means seeing things properly, with a proper light, with awakened vision. Your mind is your bondage. Your mind leads you to freedom. Mind can make anything out of anything. Any situation can be experienced as any situation. It can either enjoy or suffer the same situation. It can experience joy or being defamed in the same situation. It can comprehend pleasure or pain in the same situation. It can make you experience anything out of anything. Here, Patanjali says, these five modifications, right knowledge, wrong knowledge, imagination, sleep, and memory. This five can be the reasons for your pleasure or pain, for your anguish or joy, for your peace or restlessness. You can use this five towards anything. Sometimes people ask me, how can right knowledge be the reason for suffering, Swamiji? How can we use right knowledge for suffering? Here Patanjali says, all these five can be reason for suffering or joy. People understand, an enlightened person should be very calm, cool, collective, balanced. This is a kind of a right knowledge. But they use that knowledge and start creating guilt, expectations, difficulties inside them. Even right knowledge in the wrong hands can create suffering, can create difficulties. I have seen people having some idea about how life should be, this, that. Actually, if you see, it will be right knowledge, just like this situation. I was telling you a story, one Zen master crying when his master died. We have an idea, enlightened person should not cry. He is supposed to be balanced. It's a kind of a right knowledge only. But when you apply, misunderstand, misuse, it can create agony inside you. You can use that same idea to create guilt in you, or questions in you, doubt in you. Even right knowledge in the hands of wrong person can create suffering. Of course, wrong knowledge always creates suffering. People ask me, one more question. Patanjali says here, all these five can create right, can create joy or suffering. How can wrong knowledge create joy? Can create suffering, we know. How can wrong knowledge create joy? Sometimes, accidentally, even wrong knowledge leads you to joy. Even wrong knowledge leads you to next level, next step. I have seen many instances. They may not know the reason, the right reason, but they do the right act. Without knowing right reason, without having the knowledge about right reason, but doing right act, that kind of situations, even wrong knowledge leads you to joy. Wrong knowledge leads you to pleasure. Actually, what really needs to happen inside us It's a cognitive shift. Means your comprehension should be illumined. Straight away able to relate with the truth without difficulties, complications, torturing. Straight away ability to relate with the truth. I've seen many times in my experience, people can neither resist the joy and ecstasy of being in my presence, but nor they can drop their arrogance, nor they can come out of their ego. They continue to come and continue to criticize something. I tell them, if you are feeling like criticizing, don't come, relax, be where you are. They are not able to, no. That we can't do. They will continue to come, but continue to criticize something. They can neither keep themselves away, nor completely able to surrender or relax. Means the wrong comprehension. The cognitive shift has not happened. Here, Patanjali emphasizes on cognitive shift. Let us understand all these five modifications. Right knowledge, wrong knowledge, imagination, sleep and memory. Today we will enter into imagination. Imagination, same way, can lead you to joy or pain, suffering or ecstasy. See, almost all meditation techniques are based on imagination. Except very few techniques, the clicks, what I call initiations, except the initiations directly from the master, all other techniques use imagination. For example, the unclutching, the science of unclutching, are the first technique which Patanjali spoke. Your mind is not a thing, it is an action. Stop. This is not using your imagination. This is a straight initiation. Straight initiation, straight click. Except this kind of initiations, this kind of clicks, all other techniques are using your imagination. When the imagination is used to lead to pleasure, to make you experience ecstasy, it is called meditation. The same imagination is used to lead you into suffering, it is called mind. There are only two things. Either your mind can continuously condition you, or it can continuously liberate you. Your imagination can either go this way or that way. It cannot stand still. It cannot stand still. We need to understand this one fact. We always think, I may not be progressing spiritually, but I am stuck somewhere where I am. No. Either you progress or you are going down. There is no such thing as stuck. Please be very clear. There is no such thing as stuck. Either you are going up or going down, like skiing. There is no such thing that you can stop or stand stuck. No. It doesn't happen in the inner field. If your imagination is used by you to liberate yourself, to uncondition yourself, it is called meditation. If your imagination is used to bind you more and more, to create more and more bondage, it is called mind conditioning. I have seen even the great knowledge about yoga, people start using it for one more conditioning. I have seen thousands of people reading Yoga Sutra, they will be depressed because they misuse this knowledge, they abuse this knowledge, they misinterpret this knowledge, they start imagining their own things out of this knowledge. That is why this great truth should be heard directly from an enlightened being. Then he knows where Patanjali put comma, where Patanjali gave strong emphasis, where Patanjali gave the back gap. He knows. Please understand, the other day I was reading a beautiful line. God is nowhere. Somebody put a comma next to W. Then it says, God is now here. Sometime you need an enlightened person to put the comma, to create the gap. Only he knows where Patanjali gave gap, where Patanjali put the comma. The other slogan I read, there is only one God. One guy put the comma, next to the word there is only one. Then it reads, there is only one God. First line it says, there is only one God. It's more like a moral science, uniting all the religions, creating peace. The second line, there is only one, comma, God. It's a spiritual experience. It's a spiritual truth. These two statements may look similar, but it has tremendous different significance. Its significance is totally different. See, there is only one God. It can be uttered by anybody. Everybody utters the same thing, but they say in the end, there is only one God, that is my God, not your God. That is where the problem starts. Everybody accepts there is only one God, no doubt. But everybody says, that God is only my God, not your God. The path to that God is only my path, not your path. That is where the problem starts. So if you put one comma, there is only one God, there is only one comma, God, then it's a spiritual experience. This statement means there is only one thing, nothing else. So, when you listen to these great truths from an enlightened master, you know where to put the comma, you know where Patanjali gave the gap, you know where he emphasized, you know where he was connecting or disconnecting words. Imagination can either lead you to hell or heaven. Imagination can lead either towards this direction or that direction. I can give you thousands of examples, thousands of stories. Especially I am constantly working with people's imaginations. It's my life. Last 6 years, I'm working with imaginations of the people. Millions of people directly and millions indirectly. Either trying to remove their imagination, alter their imagination, or redirect their imagination. Just today, one of my disciples was telling me, before she used to come regularly to the ashram, her daughter will always object, "Why are you going there? You are not attending us. You are not caring for us." The family pressure. Now, she also, daughter also attended the program. Now she says, "How could you come back? How could you be away from him?" "I am not able to. I am not able to be away from him. Earlier, how are you able to come back even after being around him?" So her imagination, when she had wrong imagination, she was not able to relate with the mother. She was fighting with her, saying, "Where are you going?" Now when she has the right imagination, she is fighting with her. Why did you come back? It's a mind. It is imagination. Continuously, I'm working with imaginations of the people. Many times, the imaginations become so strong, they can either completely move from the spiritual path or completely get enlightened. People sometimes ask me, how can imagination lead to enlightenment? After all, it is mental activity. How can that lead you to enlightenment? It's like somebody taking poison. Taking poison is an action, but that can lead them to death beyond actions. Same way, the right imagination is taken, the mind will disappear, you will be beyond the mind. You will be beyond mind. You will be experiencing the no mind state or the ecstasy. The next thing, sleep. Patanjali says, sleep can lead you to joy or suffering, anguish or non-anguish. Almost one third of our life we spend in sleeping. So if you understand the right technique for sleeping, one third of your life you can spend in samadhi. See, the only difference between your sleep and samadhi state, the ultimate enlightened state, is samadhi minus awareness is your sleep. Your sleep plus awareness is samadhi. Enlightenment is nothing but being aware when you are asleep. That's all. When you are asleep, there are no samskara engrams active. There are no memories active. You are completely silent, relaxed, settled. In that state, but only one thing, one difference, you are not aware. See, in the deep sleep, you are entering into the same space in which Buddha is living, in which Ramakrishna is living, in which Meera is dancing, in which Chaitanya is singing. You are entering into the same space where they are all living. Only one difference. You are not aware. Patanjali is aware. Chaitanya is aware. Krishna is aware. Buddha is alive. In that space, if you know how to be alive, if you learn how to be aware, you have done everything. Nothing else needs to be done. All you need to do is how to be alive when you are asleep. How to be aware when you are asleep. Now our problem is, how, forget about how to be aware when you are asleep. How to be aware when we are awake? How to be aware when we are awake? That is a big problem. That itself is a big problem. Today we will practice a technique to convert your sleep into samadhi. Convert your sleep into samadhi. Please understand. When I say being aware during your sleep, I don't mean sleeplessness. I am not saying be sleepless. No. That is sleep disorder. That is a disease. I am not saying be sleepless. A sleep disorder. You will be sleeping, but your whole awareness will be alive. Means there are no engrams, there are no thoughts, there are no memories, but the pure I will be alive. That will be radiating. That will exist. There is a very powerful technique called Yoga Nidra. Falling asleep consciously. Falling into the deep sleep state with awareness. I can say, if you can drop into that state with awareness and come back, suddenly your whole system will be new. Your whole system will be different. Your whole system will respond to the world in a completely different way. If you fall asleep, if you sleep very deeply, if you have a good sleep and come out, your system will be fresh. It will respond to the world in a very different way. If you are stuck in the dream state and come out, your system will be different and it will not respond properly to the life, to the day. If you fall into the samadhi and come out, if you fall into that deeper state than the deep sleep and come out, you will eternally respond to this world only through joy, only through bliss. That is why we call that state as eternal bliss. If you experience that state and come out, you will see you are radiating eternal bliss, eternal joy. Sleep is one of a 5 modifications Patanjali speaks about. There is so much we can talk about sleep. So much can be said about sleep. Maybe instead of saying, we'll use a technique by the end of today's session. A very powerful technique. How to relax with awareness. How to go into deepest states of sleep with awareness. Usually we don't sleep more than 20 to 25 minutes. Then we come back, continue to dream, play in the dream world, then again fall asleep. After 20 to 25 minutes, come back and move in the dream state, have some dreams, then again fall asleep. That is why early morning when we get up, we don't feel we had a good rest. Because you never rested. You are continuously playing the game. Your body might be resting or your body might be relaxing, but you are not in a relaxed mood. You are not completely resting. You are not aware. You are not in peace. The sleep can be used for suffering or joy. That state can be manipulated to reach samadhi state or to be in suffering state. I have seen people using sleep to lead to suffering. Either they oversleep or they continue to suffer without sleep. Sleeplessness or oversleeping. If they don't sleep in the night time, the chronic fatigue will be there in their body. It will continue to disturb their creativity. Whole day, they will be constantly disturbed. The creativity will not express. Or if they sleep whole day, there is no time for creativity. There is no possibility for creativity. Sometimes people wake up only sun comes through the window. Sometimes the bad part of this whole thing is windows in the west side. Tired of taking rest. Human being is the only animal who are tired of taking rest. Any other animal, morning if you wake up, you will be fresh, jump, act, very alive. Human being is the only animal, when he wakes up in the morning, just rolls and pulls the blanket. Especially that early morning sleep with the blanket will be tired of taking rest. Sleep is the 4th item, Patanjali says, which can lead us to either suffering or joy. The 5th item is memory. is a very powerful thing. Please understand. Memory is what I call pain body. Here, with the right knowledge, only with your action, connection with it can create suffering or joy. With the wrong knowledge, only your response can create joy or pain. With imagination, only your supporting to imagination, only that can create joy or pain. With the sleep, your support to the sleep, your thought also, if it is done, only then you will have joy or pain. But with memory, you don't need to do anything. They are independent. Suddenly they will come up, they will occupy your whole inner space, put you in suffering. For no reason. You can't say, where did you come? They are uninvited guests. Memory is uninvited guest. Suddenly you come and create so much of joy in your inner space and fill you with ecstasy. You can't ask, how did you come? Why did you come? Who invited you? No. Suddenly some memories will raise. You know you are in joy. You are in ecstasy. Why that memory came? Why so strongly it came? You can neither question nor understand. Suddenly you know the memory of master is inside you. For last 10 minutes you are in ecstasy. You are in joy, just soaked in his memory, being in his presence. You can't say, why did this memory came? You can't ask your mind, how this memory came? Same way, suddenly, memories which you don't want to cherish, some suffering will raise. You can't even ask, why did it come? And your whole day is gone. Your whole day is gone. Just one wrong memory, one wrong awakening, your whole day will be in depression, low mood. Memory is such a powerful thing. It can come up by itself and put you in joy or suffering, put you in anguish or peace, put you in bliss or suffering. It can lead you to anything on its own, by its own right. It doesn't need cooperation from your side. Right knowledge, wrong knowledge, imagination and sleep needs cooperation from your body and mind. All the other four things, your body and mind needs to cooperate. But with imagination, with memory, you don't need to cooperate at all. It will just erupt and you don't know why it is there. You can't ask why it is there. You can't even question why did you come. But you are in suffering or joy. That is the power of memory. Memory means the ideas, thoughts, imaginations, visualizations, collected, which is still alive inside your system. One important thing, if your memory is complete, it won't lead you to suffering, it will lead you to joy. But it is not complete. If your memory about your past, if it is complete, you will have knowledge about your future. Please understand. I am not giving you false promise. I am stating simple straight truth. If your memory about past is clean and pure, complete, you will have a clear idea about your future. Because your future is nothing but the reproduction of the past in different dimension. That's all. Maybe the sum of the quantity will be different, but basic structure will be the reproduction of your past. Earlier you might have had one car in the past, the future you may have few cars. But the future is going to be the reproduction of the past. But the big problem is we don't even have the right idea about our past. We remember our past only after editing. If you think your whole life is suffering, as we usually think, you will edit and connect only all the suffering incidents. And you will think your whole life past was suffering. That one idea is enough to feel, to imagine, to visualize, to think your whole life was suffering. The memory, it is not a right memory, it's a wrong memory. Same way, if you think your whole life is joy, again you will edit, cut, fix, paste and see your whole life as joy. You will connect all the joyful incidents, memory and start seeing your whole life as joy. We never comprehend, we don't have the complete memory. We don't look at the past as it happened. We don't smell the past as it happened, as it is. If you have a simple, straight idea about the memory, past, a simple, straight, clear idea, you will have simple, straight, clear idea about the future. Your miscomprehension, your wrong idea about the past is responsible for the wrong idea about the future. If you think you are not able to plan your future, be very clear, you don't have a vision about your past. Any incident happened in the past adds some juice to your being, understanding to your being, awareness to your being, knowledge to your being, experience to your being. So if you are aware of all those memories, that knowledge, that essence which is added to your being will continue to guide you in the future. But when you forget those incidents, those memories, when memory loss happens, which is happening in all of us, that juice of that experience, knowledge of that experience, memory of that experience will not express itself in the future. So confusion. Understand, right knowledge, wrong knowledge, imagination, sleep and memory, these are the five modifications leads you to suffering or anguish. So realize all these five can be either used or abused. Just this knowledge, this understanding that it can be used or abused, it can lead to joy or suffering, is enough. That is enough. You will start using them rightly. Whenever all this file is leading you to suffering, you are abusing it, you are misusing it. Whenever it is leading you to joy, you are using it properly. So whenever you are in suffering, understand, some one of these five is misused by you. So decide, you will use that properly. Whenever you are in joy, understand, these five, any one or all the five are used by you rightly.